The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Welcome to the world of terrifying imagination. To the world of enchantment, spells, the witchery. These are all words from our childhood. Pleasant memories of nursery stories before bedtime. The dark side of magic we knew nothing of. And when we grew old enough to learn, dismissed as ignorance and superstition. But once again in our times, incantation, exorcism, and the haunting belief in demonic possession are alive and abroad. They are what this strange tale is about.
I tell you, Doctor, it's the God's honest truth. They brought the young man in on the rolling stretcher to the emergency room, and he had this big sort of dent in his head. Oh, he didn't look like he was breathing at all. There was me, with me bucket and me pail, trying to clean up. Just me and the young man on the stretcher, and the old wino repeater we called PJ, they brought in earlier, snoring and dribbling. And that's when it happened. Came right out of old PJ's mouth, and across the room, and right up the young man's nose, like that. With a burny, cindery smell, like the old scissor grinder stone wheel used to make. Oh, a great black cloud with red eyes in the middle and a long forked tail. Oh, I take an oath on it on me mother's grave. It was the devil himself.
Our mystery drama, Possessed by the Devil, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Donald Buka. It is sponsored in part by Contact, the 12-hour cold capsule, and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, brewers of Budweiser. I'll be back shortly with Act One. From the beginnings of history, it is there in some form. Possession. The incubus who ravishes maidens while asleep. The succubus who tempts man into seduction in his dreams. The dibbuk, that lost soul who dies before his time and is compelled to wander in space till he can steal a body to live out his allotted years. Fact? Superstition? Hallucination? Here is such a modern legend. You be the judge.
Okay, Doctor, an IV set up for old Wally Wino here. Glucose, we'll start it right away.
Yes, Dr. Daniels.
Oh, he don't look like he's long for this world.
He hasn't got a cell he hasn't drowned in alcohol. His liver is like a washboard. But I'm not sure I concur with your diagnosis, Mrs. Gideon. Still, I don't know this time. Oh, another emergency. And this is supposed to be the quiet hour.
Do you want me to get out for a while, Doctor? I'm near finished.
No, go ahead with your cleaning. Just don't get run over by the stretcher. Put him over here, boys. Now, what have you brought me this time?
Oh, you poor old souse. Dead to the world's the word for you, all right. You got me sympathy. With my arthritis, many's the time I've been tempted to have a go at the hard stuff myself. Oh, but thanks to sweet Mary, she's held me back. A little sacramental wine to ease me bones keeps me going. I had a few tonight, I can tell you. Oh, but there's always them breath sweeteners to take it away, I hope.
Well, how's your patient, Mrs. Gideon?
Oh, Doctor, I hope he's not a Catholic. The father might never make it in time. How's yours?
Oh, mine's out of my league. What I need is a brain surgeon. Speak of the devil. Considine just walked past the door. Dr. Considine, Dr. Considine, sir, I've got an emergency here.
Mother of heaven, and me here alone with two near corpses. I didn't see it. I couldn't have. Oh, but I did. I seen it. Oh, the good saints preserve me.
Hey there, Mother. Well, where am I?
Oh, in the Mercy Hospital. Oh. Oh, you shouldn't be getting up.
Oh, ma'am, you're sure a different kind of nurse.
Oh, I'm no nurse. I'm the cleaning woman.
Oh.
And you hadn't oughtn't to be sitting up? Not with that clout on the head someone's after giving you.
Huh? What clout on the head?
Why, that great big dent as big as a soap plate they brought you in with.
What are you talking about?
I'm late for the operating room already.
Dr. Considine, he has a depressed skull fracture. I don't even know if he's still alive. Good Lord, what are you doing on your feet? Dr. Considine, will you help me get him back on the...
Hey, hold up. Wait a minute. Look, there's nothing wrong with me.
Mister, an ambulance just brought you in here with a skull fracture. You were out cold in deep shock.
But there's nothing wrong. There's nothing the matter with my head. Look.
Holy Mother.
Excuse me, Mr.
Mike. Michael Damon.
Oh, well, I'm Dr. Considine, Chief of Neurological Surgery here at the hospital. Would you mind sitting down on this chair for a second and letting me check you out?
Well, sure, Doc. Look, I've got to admit, I don't remember how I got here to the hospital, so maybe you ought to have a look at me.
Mrs. Gideon, what's the matter with you? You look like you just saw a ghost.
It wasn't no ghost, sir.
Dr. Daniels, get over here.
Yes, sir.
Would you mind casting your eagle eye over the back of this young man's head and show me one scintilla of evidence of skull fracture or concussion?
Doctor, all I know is Jake Bronstein brought him in on the wagon and he had a decompressed area you could have laid your hand in.
That's right, sir. I saw it myself.
Someone here has been drinking. Daniels, look. If this is your idea of a joke, I...
Never
mind. We'll discuss this later. Mr. Damon?
Yes, Doctor?
For your own protection as well as the hospital's, may I suggest that we take some x-rays of your head? Oh, nurse?
Yes?
You can let Dr. Daniels take over on the IV with the old man. And we'll, Mr. Damon, straight to x-ray. I want a full set of head plate.
Yes, Doctor.
Now, Mr. Damon, there are a couple of questions I'd like to ask you.
Excuse me, sir. Dad?
Mike? You all right, son?
Oh, I feel fine, Dad, except for a headache. Oh, Dr. Considine, this is my father, Reverend Damon.
Oh, how do you do? Nurse, can we get going?
Yes, sir.
Dad, what happened? How did I get here?
Well, perhaps you can explain, Reverend, as we walk along. I want to get to x-ray.
Well, I wish someone could explain to me what happened.
I can, sir.
Let me check the IV on old PJ. Wait a minute.
What is it, Doctor?
PJ here. He's bought it this time.
Oh,
this is not my night. We might have pulled him through. Oh, there's going to be the devil to pay around here.
Oh, you can say that again. It's the God's truth, Dr. Considine. Came right out of the old man's mouth and across the room and up the young man's nose like that. With a burning, cindery smell, like the old scissor grinder's wheel used to make. A great black cloud with red eyes in the middle, and a long forked tail. Oh, I've taken off on me mother's grave. 'Twas the devil himself.
Yes, Mrs. Gideon, I think you can leave the medical discussion to us, and I'm sure you have important work waiting.
Oh, bless us, I left me pail and mop there. I hope nobody's been after stealing that mop. It had a brand new head on it.
Well, at least I know now where the smell of alcohol came from. I can't blame you for that, Daniels.
Sure.
But I just can't accept it. In an emergency room, you concentrate on a seemingly healthy patient while you lose a really sick old man.
PJ was a repeater, Doc. He's long overdue for uremic poisoning or cardiac arrest. But this young guy, Damon...
Well, complete your sentence.
I was just thinking... That magnificent body, physically way above par, and the injury I thought I saw, well, would have left him a vegetable for the rest of a long life if we'd pulled him through.
What injury?
That depressed fracture.
Most of the brain should have been injured beyond repair.
You say what you thought you saw. Apparently you didn't see anything.
You heard Mrs. Gideon back me up, Doctor.
Come in.
Oh, it's the wet plates, Doctor, from X-ray.
Light up the viewing fields, Daniels, and let's have a good look. Yeah, satisfied?
Well, sir...
Oh, somebody gave him a knock on the head, all right. There's some exterior evidence of that, but of any fracture?
None I can see.
Well, you're the doctor of record. Shall we send him home?
I see no reason not to.
Okay. Now I'd better get up to O.R. Coming! Coming! Trudy!
Well, don't look so disappointed, Rod.
You could. Come in. Say, sweetheart, what are you doing here at this hour?
Oh, I couldn't sleep after your call, so I drove over. Is Mike back from the hospital?
No, I thought the bell was Dad and Mike. They're on the way home right now.
How come you didn't go to the hospital?
Well, we've been trying to get in touch with Anton Azarak.
Oh?
So Dad thought one of us should be here in case he called back.
Oh.
I mean, to find out what happened. Yeah. All right, Janda. Cool it.
Oh, what a name for a cat.
Why, I see nothing wrong with it. I think a martyr belongs in a minister's family.
Oh, is that my fate as your wife to be?
Of course not. We just called her that because Mike and she never seem to get along.
Well, it's hard to figure about the cat. Mike is such a kind, gentle sort of a giant. I thought all animals loved him.
Well, it depends what the word includes. Oh, wait a minute. There's a car now. The return of the prodigal son. Now maybe we'll find out just what happened last night.
And that's honestly all I can tell any of you.
You were making a fresh fire in the fireplace at 5:30 in the morning and straightened up too fast and knocked yourself cold on the underside of the mantelpiece?
Well, what other explanation is there, Rod?
Well, it is solid oak. And that big round ornamental sphere is a menace. I've regretted it every time I've bumped my own head on it.
Yeah, but Dad, you never hit your head hard enough to knock yourself cold.
Mike, why were you making a fire at that time in the morning?
Well, I wasn't actually making one. I was replacing one. Professor Azarek was with me last night, coaching me for an exam I have coming up, and, well, he got cold.
Oh, come on, it wasn't cold enough for a fire last night.
Well, maybe when you went to bed, but we were up all night. And the professor's a pretty old man.
What were you doing up at that hour in the morning, Dad?
I really don't know. Something woke me and I...
Are you all right, Reverend Jase?
Excuse me, Trudy, dear. Yes, I'm fine. I'm just recalling that moment this morning. How vivid it was. I was startled out of the depths of my sleep to wide awakeness. I had a vision of Mike surrounded by flames. It was so real, I even said a little prayer. Then I hopped out of bed, went to the window. It wasn't very dark anymore. And looking across, I could see that all the studio lights were on and the front door open. And I thought I'd better go and have a look.
And when you got there, you found Mike on the floor unconscious?
Yes. Lying on his face, white as a sheet, and deathly cold.
Oh.
Yeah, but what made you call the hospital? It's not like you to panic.
Well, I realized that, but the back of his head looked as though he'd been felled by some superhuman male fist. It was all bent inward.
I thought the hospital said Mike was all right.
Oh, I am, Trudy. A clean bill of health. Nothing to worry about.
My fault. Must have been an illusion, of course.
Well, I think if the Inquisition is over, I'm going to make up on some sleep. Oh, that damn cat! I'd forgotten about her. Will you keep her in there away from me?
What's the matter with her?
Been a very strange night and morning. And I have a hauntingly uneasy feeling.
You mean about Mike?
About Mike. I hope the hospital was right to give him a clean bill of health. He doesn't seem himself at all. Not at all.
Hello. Azarek? Michael, what the hell happened last night? Okay, not on the phone. I'm going to rest now. But you be sure to be here tonight.
So far in our modern legend, we have caught up with superstition, witches, magic, both black and white, enchantment, spells, abracadabra. Well, there are two more acts to come. I'll be back very shortly with Act Two. A young man rushed to the hospital with a depressed fracture of the skull, which should have mangled his brain. A chronic drunken repeater back in emergency on the edge of fatal acute alcoholism, and an aging cleaning woman who thought she saw a malign spirit pass from the drunk to the young man. Now, apparently in full health, we'll be able to appraise just how healthy the young man who made his remarkable recovery is.
Be right there. Professor Azarek, please come in.
And must you be so formal?
After last night and today, I'm taking no chances. Maybe with your superior intelligence, you have no worries about our abortive attempt at Satanism. But I have. Look, I was the victim, and since a crack on the head denied me any knowledge of what happened, I'm only hoping you can give me the straight goods.
The straight goods. A peculiarly inept term for what we are engaged in, my brother in Satan.
Damn it, it's not a deal in semantics, Anton. Now, what happened after I summoned up the fiend? I mean, how did you escape, and how could I have been harmed? As long as I was safe in the magic triangle within the circle.
I warned you to keep your feet still. If you touch any part of the circle itself or the triangle within it, you are at the mercy of all the devils in hell.
And if I'd known what I was getting into when I picked your philosophy course, I'd have quit.
You made the mistake of not realizing how vulnerable your soul was as the son of a minister.
All right. I'm not crying over what happened. I just want to know what it was. Now, where was I?
By the fireplace, lying prostrate. The way you fell after he hit you.
Who hit me?
The devil you summoned.
But where did he appear?
Outside the circle here.
The inner or the outer?
Beyond the outer, of course. There was water scattered between the circles, and wolfsbane scattered through it. And within the circle, you had the brazier burning.
Everything as you ordered it and arranged it.
Yes, but...
But what went wrong?
Your ego.
My ego? What does that mean?
You lost your head. Or at least almost did. This was a simple experiment by someone who seemed a true psychic to raise a minor antichrist. The motive was strong enough to create belief. Or at least the hope of belief. You wanted a familiar to procure your brother's woman for you. Beshal, you were to call forth. Why did you call on Ashtaroth, a giantess beyond your control?
I don't know. But do I have to explain?
No. Ever since you became my disciple, you told me that you have lusted after the woman your brother brought home as his bride.
The only thing I've never been able to take from Rod whenever I wanted.
When you finished the incantation and summoned Ashtaroth, I thought the house would come down about our ears. The earth rocked like the San Francisco quake. And suddenly she stood without the circle, a huge figure in chainmail and medieval armor. Meddler and slave, she said. How dare you summon me for your petty desires? Learn this lesson once, if not for all. Turn your face from me in shame. And as you turned, she reached out with her mailed glove and struck you on the top and back of your head. You dropped like a stone.
Across the magic circles?
They weren't designed for major devils.
You swore no presence could cross them.
Nothing but her arm and her fist.
That's 5 feet from that outer circle to the center of the triangle where I was standing.
I told you the circle was for lesser demons.
What happened after she struck me?
The spirit disappeared. The room was clogged with smoke. I opened the door to let it out and came back to you. You had fallen almost into the fireplace. I pulled the rug back, arranged the furniture as best I could, and fled. I thought you were dead.
Oh, I'm alive.
Yes, yes, but it's not possible. When I left you just before sunrise, you were dead.
What witchcraft can do, it can undo. Whoever and whatever I am, I'm alive. Make no mistake about that. Goodbye, Anton. I don't need you anymore.
Oh, hi, Trudy. I thought you'd gone with Rod and Dad.
Hello, Mike. I thought you were over in the studio.
We ran out of beer.
Ah, you're out of luck. Rod's bringing some home.
Well, I found something more refreshing.
What?
You.
Oh, if you'd waited just a little longer, you'd have found me anyway. I was going to wander over to the studio and visit you.
Oh, so that's why you stayed home.
Oh, don't be silly. Someone had to wash the dishes. As long as I'm house guest, I thought I ought to do something for my keep.
Well, you're staying here tonight?
One whole week. Mom went up with Pops to his 35th class reunion. And they figured that with one full-fledged minister and a recent hospital dropout, I was suitably chaperoned.
Safe as a church, huh? Rod and Dad say when they'd be back?
Not till pretty late, I guess.
Mm.
Pretty rough section of town. That's why Rod insisted on going along.
Mm, what's the occasion?
That's one of your father's oldest parishioners. I guess the old lady is dying. She asked for the minister.
Well, her loss, my gain.
What?
Oh, nothing. It's just a stupid joke. You said you wanted to see the studio?
Oh, yes. Would you mind?
Mind? Look, I'm out of beer, but I've got some champagne that's begging to be what it is.
What is it?
A split. Just right for sharing. Shall we go? Well, won't you walk into my parlor, said Beelzebub to the flies.
Oh, no, what's that supposed to mean?
That is the advantage of a classical education.
Uh-huh.
Beelzebub, god of the Philistine city of Ekron. You know, he was known as the Lord of the Flies.
Why?
Well, now there you've got me.
Uh-oh, he sounds horrid.
Well, he wasn't very popular with Christians. In fact, they called him the Prince of Devils.
Lord of the Flies.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, it gives me the creeps.
Here's something to chase your creeps away.
Oh, I don't want that, Mike. It goes right to my head.
Oh, just a sip, hmm? A good luck toast to sister and brother-in-law-hood, our getting-to-know-you party.
Well, far be it from me to be a party pooper. There's nothing more cozy and reassuring than a room full of books. What's this section here?
Oh, that? That's the main reason I needed Dad's particular library, since my exam was in metaphysics.
The Black Arts, The World of Witches, Essentials of Demonology, Satanic Mass. Oh, it's a strange collection for a minister.
Well, it's always good to know your enemy. Your dad's quite an authority on the devil and his work.
And you? Are you thinking of becoming a minister, Mike?
Me? No. Perish the thought. No, my philosophy is too easy for that. I long ago decided that if you can't fight him, join him. Can't you see how evil I am? Tempting you with spirituous beverages, coaxing you here to my lair, and now, having anesthetized my prey, making ready to spring.
I don't think you're being very funny, Mike. Oh, is this where you hit your head?
Hmm? Oh, yes, yes, so they say. No, I wasn't being altogether funny.
What do you mean?
Trudy, have you any idea how jealous I am of my older brother?
Of Rod? Why?
A month ago, or whenever it was, they turned up with you. My first thought was,
Why couldn't I find something like that?
That's very flattering, Mike. But you're a little young for the big step.
Not so young as you think. Perhaps. I don't care what you and Rod have been to each other. It was me you wanted. Still want. Only you're afraid of breaking your word.
This is a joke.
It's no joke.
Mike, let go of me.
You wanted me from the moment you laid eyes on me, just as I have you.
Oh, you've been reading too many naughty books.
Don't laugh. There's nothing funny about this.
No, not really. Offensive.
You're afraid of me.
Don't be silly.
You're afraid of yourself.
Now that really is the last straw.
Test it. Test it. Fasten your mouth to mine. Wind yourself about me. Try forbidden love, and it will never let you go.
No, Mike, let me go. You're hurting me. Oh, that's Rod home with your father. If you won't let me go, I'll scream.
What are you going to tell them?
Nothing. Nothing. I wouldn't want them to know what a pig you are. I think that blow on the head must have done more damage than you think. Mike, you better see a psychiatrist. Hi, Rod. Dad. Well, we didn't expect you.
Esther, by Lucifer, I'll have you yet, cowering at my feet like a slave, to use you once and destroy you, as I shall use your surrogate tonight, whoever she may be.
Oh, dear, how bestial.
What, Reverend Damon?
Just something that happened to a girl on the other side of town.
Let me see. Rachel. Awful.
Well, now you got me going. You too, Jean? Well, since you can't read, I'll read it to you. The body of Elizabeth Migler, 21, was discovered in Marsden Park today by a passerby. Although it was later determined the girl had been raped, the strange features of the case are that she was not robbed, and as though by some ferocious animal, tooth marks showed that her throat had been literally ripped to pieces. Good Lord.
Where is Marsden Park?
Clear over the other side of town.
When did it happen?
Night before last. Morning, all. I hope breakfast is all ready. I'm famished. What's wrong with that cat? Oh, it's beginning to bug me.
A lot of things are beginning to bug me.
What'd you say, honey?
Nothing, Rod. I don't think I'll have any breakfast this morning. I don't feel like eating. No, Rod, please, don't come with me. I'd rather be alone.
Lover's quarrel?
Look, will you just fake out, brother mine? It's none of your business.
For Trudy's sake, for everyone's sake, would that it were. But, unfortunately, we know better. Or do we? The crime happened miles away. And the devil that may possess Mike is there only on the evidence of a tipsy charwoman. Who summons the devil never calls for him in vain. And once met, few are lucky to get rid of him again. I'll return shortly with Act Three. In the kitchen of the Damon house, Rod glares angrily at his brother, who shrugs it off and goes to the refrigerator for orange juice. A troubled Reverend Damon eyes both his sons as he closes and folds the tabloid in his hands, as if it were just as unclean as it is. Rod, unchallenged by Mike, breaks the silence first.
I'd better go on upstairs and check on Trudy.
Well, she said she wanted to be alone.
Look, will you stay out of this?
I'm not even in it. Just an objective comment.
So keep it to yourself.
Now, come on, Rod. I didn't mean to butt in. Catch me up. What's all the hostility about?
No hostility. Just a reaction to a peculiarly unpleasant crime. I think I'll go up and apologize to Trudy for spoiling everyone's breakfast.
That's a good idea, Dad.
If I can leave you two alone.
Well, I have no quarrel with anyone.
Now, forget it, Dad. I just got upset over Trudy. I shouldn't have jumped on Mike.
Then let me see if I can make our future in-law a little happier in our house.
What happened, Rod? Oh, it all started over this tabloid story about some poor kid who got raped and mangled in Marsden Park.
Oh? Here, read all about it.
Kind of gruesome, all right. But there's one of these every day.
Yeah, but not in such gory detail. It really got to Trudy. You know, I've never seen her upset like that. I mean, so subjectively involved.
Oh? What do you suppose triggered that?
Oh, I don't know. I just sure wish I did.
Maybe it's better to let sleeping dogs lie.
Who is it?
Your future father-in-law. May I come in for a minute?
Just a sec. The door's locked.
Come on in, Reverend Damon.
Feeling any better?
Oh, not really.
Oh, I should be ashamed of myself reading that yellow sheet. I like to think it helps keep my sense of balance, but maybe I'm just a seeker of vicarious excitement.
Like that rather complete collection on Satanism and the occult that you have in your studio?
Ah, you noticed that, did you?
Night before last, when I was over there with Mike while you and Rod had gone to see your old parishioner who was dying. Did she?
As a matter of fact, no. She made a remarkable recovery.
Oh, really? Well, you looked so sort of worried when you came home. I thought she...
I was worried about you, Trudy. And Mike.
Why?
You, because I knew you were upset about something. Well, you can't be a minister for over 40 years without learning to read something about people.
And Mike?
Mike is an enigma to me since I brought him back from the hospital. A rather terrifying thought to realize I've lost contact with my own son. I'd like to ask your help, Trudy, and I'll lay it right on the line. Why were you at the studio with him? And what happened there?
You won't tell Rod?
Not if you don't want me to.
And what I'd like more than anything is to tell someone, most of all you, for Mike's sake. Because I think he needs help. And you're the only one who could bring it to him or make him go find it.
Reverend Damon, this is a pleasure. I'm on my way to a class. Can we talk as we cross campus?
Yes. Just, what is the name of your course that Mike is taking?
Philosophy. Perhaps more specifically, metaphysics. Rather freewheeling. I mean, it's advanced and we spend more time on the perimeters than we do on the core subjects.
Just what were you and Mike up to that long night before his injury?
I was coaching him for an examination.
An examination in what? On what subject?
Why, the class I teach, general philosophy.
And you left before Michael was hurt?
Oh, good Lord, yes. Would I have left the boy if he were injured?
Would you have fled the scene unless you were up to something dark and vile enough to stain your reputation?
I am sorry your boy was hurt. I had no part in it. I resent your holier-than-thou accusations. If you'll excuse me, I have a class waiting for me.
Now for the rug. There. Does it? Oh, my dear Lord. Just what I was afraid of.
What are you afraid of, Dad?
You, Mike, that you'd turned away from God to seek the devil.
Why, Mike? Why? Who knows? Now, what shall I tell you? That life's a drag. It has no purpose, no goals, no triumphs that aren't tarnished. That there's no good in man. Nothing but pettiness and meanness and me first and the devil take the hindmost.
That's not what I brought you up to believe.
No one blames you, Dad. But Trudy was the last straw.
that Rod could find the woman he wanted, and she could turn out to be the one that I need. So I chose his worship, and here we built my altar.
Don't desecrate that name. The altar belongs to God.
This altar belongs to Satan. See the circle traced in vermilion paint? Exactly 9 feet wide, an 8-foot charcoal one within. Light the votive candles, burn the incense, let the mass begin.
Mike, what are you doing? I won't tolerate this sacrilege.
You can no more move than the woman I desire can resist my power. I am the way. I am the darkness. I am the truth. Lord of the universe whom the winds fear. I am he whose mouth ever flameth. You answer me. The I in hope. The bornless one that did create the darkness and the light. Thee I command to serve me and send me the woman I desire.
Come in here.
But the rain.
What's going on here?
Rod, it's your brother. He's gone mad. Spawn of the outer world. Stay back. Stay back. Or I will smite thee dead where thou standest. Leave or leave except the woman who is mine.
Dad, what's going on?
Look out. He's going for Trudy.
Now look, Nick.
Oh, he has a knife.
Would you murder your own brother?
Okay, that's enough fooling around.
Did you know I could always take you?
Oh, Rod, I hope you haven't hurt him too much.
Oh, don't worry, baby. He always had a glass jaw.
He had something more perishable than that. Call the hospital. And better tell them to bring a straitjacket.
The top of the night to you, Mrs. Gideon. And what's that wee bottle in the paper bag? A little poteen?
Nothing of the sort, Dr. Smartaddick. It's a noggin of holy water blessed by me own Monsignor, which I carry with me when I come near this place ever since 3 days ago. What happened to old PJ? Did anyone ever turn up to claim him?
Nope. Oh, by the way, while we're on the gossip column, guess who's back in the hospital?
Oh, not the other one.
Mm-hmm, the same. Lying in the emergency room under a deep sedation in a straitjacket.
Oh, what did they bring him back here for?
That's what Dr. Considine and his father, the Reverend Damon, are discussing now in the prep room. Well, if you're going to swab out the emergency, you'd better get at it fast.
Well, I'll tell you something, Doctor. Mm-hmm. If I'm to be there and alone with that devil, you'll never see emergency this clean again. For I'm adding the Monsignor's holy water to me pail right now, just in case.
Of course, we'll run every neurological test in the book on him under the circumstances, Reverend Damon.
I'm not sure it will do any good. I'm afraid the trouble is psychiatric.
Well, it has to be one or the other, unless we're to accept Mrs. Gideon's diagnosis of possession.
Mrs. Gideon? Oh, I remember now. She was one of the people, like the intern, who remembered that they thought they saw a considerable skull compression.
Which never existed, believe me. Just an illusion, like Mrs. Gideon's.
What was Mrs. Gideon's illusion?
Well, I'm afraid she'd had a drink or two, and she had some wild story about a black devil streaming out of an old dipsomaniac who was also in the emergency room, and being sucked up through your son's nostrils. I'm really even embarrassed to mention such nonsense. Come in.
Excuse me, Dr. Considine, but the patient is coming too.
Mr. Damon?
Yes, sir. He's still in the straitjacket.
I think, Reverend, if you don't mind until we see what state he's in.
I don't mind. You might as well both know that the police are by now well aware that My son was responsible for the violent death of a young woman the night before last while under the possession of whatever devils or devil owns him. Shall we go?
By Nergal and Tammuz and Belphegor,
No one can hem me in. I am the Lair, Lord of the Flies, and your bonds cannot hold me.
Good Lord, he's out of the straitjacket. I'll get help.
What's going on here, Mrs. Judy?
Oh, the Lord preserve us. It's the devil incarnate. Oh, stay away from him, Doctor. He'll burn you to a crisp with his fiery breath.
All of you, stay away from him. Leave him to me. Michael, my son. Call me not by that filthy angel's name. Stay away, old man, for I carry death in my hand as a sword.
Michael!
I warned you.
Oh, you admit it's a man of the cloth. Get back! Get back!
What happened?
Oh, sure, it was the Monsignor's holy water. It's just as strong as life.
Michael, no.
All right, boys.
All right, Daniels, you're too late.
What?
Excuse me, Reverend. Let me see. Daniels, come here.
Hey, yes, sir.
Was that the depression you were talking about when this man was first brought in?
Yes, sir. That's what I thought I saw.
Well, at least it's what we all see now.
But how?
I haven't any answers. I only know... I'm sorry, Reverend Damon, but your son is dead.
He hasn't been my son since his first visit here. The mercy of God is that whatever possessed him died with him, thanks to this lady here.
Oh, if I hadn't had the holy water, the Lord does move in mysterious ways, don't he, Reverend Sir?
In mysterious ways and kind ones. What a field day the Reverend Damon's tabloids might have had if Michael had ever come to trial for the death of that poor innocent girl. Innocent. Perhaps that's the theme of this dark history. If Michael had been less innocent, and it had the guts to be less self-interested and bored, how different his world might have been. But that's the answer, isn't it? We all make our own world. We can't rely on anyone else to make it for us. I'll be back shortly. I suppose I should resist the impulse, but I have to admit I can't. It's one of the rewards for being host, particularly with guests who can't answer back, at least directly. So just for once, a homily. Reach out and find life. Take it and make the most of it. For if nothing else, our story proves to the hilt the oldest of adages. If you don't, the devil finds work for idle hands to do. Our cast included Donald Buka, Joan Shea, Ian Martin, Guy Sorrell, and Leon Janney. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Now, a preview of our next tale.
No trouble, though.
He went numb pretty fast.
I thought he would.
He wanted me to give you a message, but then he couldn't remember what it was. And he thinks you're some kind of a warden.
Poor man.
You know, Mr. Z, I didn't much like it inside that room.
You knew you were coming out.
Who ever dreamed up the black room anyway?
I've no idea.
Somebody must have.
There's always been a black room, far as I know.
Hell of a place.
Yes.
How long will he last, do you think?
Matter of days. Weeks, possibly.
Then what?
He'll go mad. Or die.
Wonder what he's doing now.
Oh, counting by twos, then by threes, then by fours. Anything to keep from thinking. That's what they all do.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.